Hey everybody, we're going to be doing another Bible study, and I was looking at what we could talk about tonight. You guys are really going to love this. I get lots of emails from you guys saying that you really enjoy these Bible studies, and I like doing them also, so as you know, the feeling is mutual. What we're going to do is we're going to do a continuing Bible study on what we call Things Jesus Said That May Shock You. Things Jesus said that may shock you. And before we get into that, I want to show you our updated website. We have some free things for you. And when you go to shotgunl.net here, this will only take me less than 40 seconds, guys. Go here where it says free audio Bible, and you could listen to the Bible and even download it to your MP3 player or your computer. I also suggest going here where it says on the bottom left, Apologetics 315, and then reasonablefaith.org. That's really good. And there was one other thing here I wanted to show you. Let me see if I could find it. Ah, this is really good right here. Passion of the Christ on the left side here. You could watch the entire movie Passion of the Christ. And then, oh, before we go, if you're into taking tests, like exams online, little test, take this one here on the bottom right, Proof God Exists, especially if you are like how I used to be. I used to be an atheist. I'm a Christian now. Click here where it says Proof God Exists and take that test, and I think you'll be amazed at what you see. Now, we're going to get into some shocking things that Jesus said, and before we do, I'm going to give you a little bonus Bible study here. We're going to talk about Abraham and Isaac, and remember when God asked Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac on the mountain. And let's talk about that, because I was in a debate with an atheist recently, and he brought this up. And a lot of atheists will bring this up and they'll say, you know, Abraham sacrificed his son Isaac, and they'll keep mentioning that, and that's actually an error. He did not sacrifice his son Isaac. What God was doing was showing Abraham how God was going to sacrifice his son Jesus Christ, and he's showing him this with Abraham and his son Isaac. So it's a big error that atheists make. They always say that Abraham sacrificed his son Isaac, and in debate I have to constantly point out their errors, which are many. So, we're going to get into the shocking things that Jesus Christ said, but first, let's go through this with you about Abraham and Isaac. It says, and it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham, and by the way, I'm reading from Genesis 22, and said unto him, Abraham, and Abraham said, Behold, here I am. And God said, Take now thy son, watch this, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Now, let's stop here and talk about this for a moment. When you actually read scripture and you read the relationship that Abraham and God had with each other, it wasn't a relationship like, let's say, how an atheist would have a relationship with God, where they just read God's word, but they're not really fellowshipping with God, and they're not even embracing God and his word, etc., right? So that's why a lot of unbelievers will not understand this, because they themselves don't have this intense relationship with God like Abraham did. So it's not like God just approaches Abraham and they've never had this very close relationship, and then he springs this on him. What's happening is God is showing Abraham what he's going to do with his son, Jesus Christ. But a lot of unbelievers are still confused, because they'll go through this, and watch as I go through this, it seems like Abraham's not really worried about anything. He's very confident. And when I actually read this, it doesn't say that, you know, Abraham put on sackcloth and ashes, and he was crying and grieving. It seems like Abraham is very confident, and he knows that God's going to show him something epic. And I'm going to give you some secrets here of why that is, because once you actually investigate the promises that God had given to Abraham, listen, guys, prior to this, you're going to realize why Abraham was so confident. So let me give you an example. Let's say that I told you that I built you a house, and the house is very structurally sound, and you've witnessed it. You've witnessed it in the storms and the torrential rain, and the house is structurally sound. You've already witnessed it with your eyes. And then I tell you, hey, you're going to go in this house, and you're going to see everything come up against this house. You're going to see a strong force come on the house, like, let's say, more thunder, more rain, or whatever, right? Well, if I promised you that the house will withstand anything, for example, you're not really going to be that, you're not going to be worried at all. Because no matter what is thrown at this house, you know that it's going to stand. Well, likewise, God had given Abraham some promises prior to Genesis 22 here. So let's go through this. Watch this. So God says, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Now, it's interesting that Abraham's not like, oh, woe is me and my son Isaac, and he doesn't start grieving and crying. And look what happens here. Abraham wakes up the next morning. He don't wake up in the afternoon. He doesn't put it off. Notice it says that Abraham rose up early in the morning. Abraham knows that God is going to show him something epic. So Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for the burnt offering. So they get all the wood ready for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, so it's like a 3-day journey here, Abraham lifted up his eyes and, notice, saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, now watch this, here's a little hidden glint, a little glint message here of Abraham's thoughts here. He says, abide ye here with the ass. Let me go through this with you guys, and let's see if you can catch something here, okay? Watch this. Let's see if you notice this. Genesis 22:5. Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. What? Did you see that? Notice. He says, I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Now, how could that happen if Isaac was going to be dead and not to live again? Now, this creates a problem for people that don't understand the promises that God had previously made. How is that possible? How is it possible that Isaac is sacrificed, which I know he wasn't sacrificed, but just roll with me here a minute. Let's say he was going to be sacrificed. It appears here that Abraham has so much confidence that God is going to provide a sacrifice. Now watch this. Let me tell you why. It says, and Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. So he gives his son all the wood, and the son's carrying it. Okay. It says, and Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, my father. And by the way, some people believe that the son was like around 14, 15 years old. Some biblical scholars believe even up to 16, 17, 18 years old, maybe 19, but more of them are around the 16-year-old age. And Abraham's a pretty old geezer by now. So we know that the son could have whipped in a fight. We know that the son would be able to handle himself. So Isaac also is in submission to God. Interesting, just like how Jesus Christ was in submission to God to become our sacrifice, our propitiation for sin. And this is what God's showing here. Isaac represents, he's like a type of Jesus Christ, and Abraham is a type of the Father offering his son, Jesus, as a sacrifice for our sins. Right now, watch this. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father, and said, remember what I told you earlier, that Abraham had faith that God was going to provide the offering. My father, Isaac says, and he said, here I am, my son. And he said, and by the way, you notice something real beautiful here. Up here in Genesis 22, where it begins, notice it says that God tempts Abraham, and Abraham says, behold, here I am, right? And then over here, the son is saying, my father, and Abraham says, here I am, my son. You see how beautiful that is? It's almost poetic. And he said, the son says, behold, the fire and the wood. And here it is, guys. Where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Now, we know God is just, and he must judge sin. You know how sometimes if someone does something wrong to you and I, because we're just imperfect people, sinners, we'll be like, well, don't do it again, you know. But we have to understand, guys, this is not God's nature. God is very holy. We are not. He is very, very just. And as humans, we are not. So God doesn't just let these things slide on by. He doesn't let injustices happen without justice being done. He must judge sin. So what I see here in this beautiful illustration here is, if it wasn't for Jesus Christ, Abraham would be sacrificing his son Isaac. We would suffer as mankind as we come under the judgment and the wrath of God. But watch this. Isaac says, where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And here in these beautiful, epic words, Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. These are spiritual words here, guys. These are spiritual words, and definitely spiritual. God will provide himself a lamb for burnt offering. So they went, both of them together, and they came to the place which God had told him of, and Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. So you have this trust that Abraham has in God, and he's going through this, and what God's doing is showing, hey, look, you see what you're experiencing here? This is what I'm going to experience with my son, Jesus Christ. He's basically showing his intense, God is showing his intense love for us, how he is going to be giving his son for us. It says, and Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But watch what happens here. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham, and look what it says again, here am I. And he said, lay not thine hand upon the lad. Notice Isaac does not get sacrificed. Neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld, here it is, thy son, thine only son, from me. And here it is, just what Abraham had confidence in, that God would provide a sacrifice. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. Now, check this out. Why was Abraham so confident? Well, these are just a few, and we still haven't got to the shocking things Jesus Christ said. We're going to get to that. But these are just a few of the promises that God had made to Abraham. Look here. He says, and I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And he says here, in Genesis 12:7. And by the way, notice I was reading from Genesis 22. So this means before Abraham and Isaac go to the mount, God promises, it says, unto your seed I will give this land. And there he built an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. Well, who's Abraham's seed? You know, his descendants. How's he going to have descendants except through Isaac, really? And the Lord said unto Abraham, after that Lot was separated from him, look, he goes through all this again. Here's the promises. He says, for all the land which you see, you, I will give it. And again, this was prior to Abraham and Isaac going up to the mountain. Look, and to your seed forever and ever. Genesis 13:16, prior to Abraham and Isaac going up to the mountain. Can you see why Abraham was so confident? How could God keep this promise if Isaac is gone? What God's showing him is, look, you can trust me. If I give you a promise, I'm going to keep it. And Abraham trusted him, and God kept his promise. Notice, and I will make your seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then your seed shall also be numbered. And again, and he brought him again. This, all this is prior to Genesis 22. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if you are able to number them. And he said to them, so shall your seed be. So we can go on and on and on. Notice he says here, Genesis 17, and I will make my covenant between me and you and will multiply you exceedingly. So Abraham had supreme confidence that the house was structurally sound. He was on a solid foundation. Now, let us move on to the shocking things that Jesus said. Now, what I'm about to tell you, these are the words of sweet, meek, gentle, loving Jesus. See, a lot of times people, they read the Bible, or they read a page of it or two, or they watch some of the movies that come out around Christmas time. But when you actually read the words that Jesus said, they're quite shocking. His words have authority. They have power. Watch what he says here. It says, then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying. So look what Jesus says here. He starts kind of putting down the religious people of that time. He says, and by the way, when I was an atheist, I would read some parts of the Bible, and it was surprising to me that it was people like you and I, maybe you're not real religious and stuff, but it was people like you and I, the ones that weren't real religious and into the traditions and stuff, just, you know, sincere folks. We admit we're not perfect and stuff, but, you know, we got a good heart, you know, and we want to do the right thing. It was people like you and I that were Jesus' friends, but it was the ultra-religious folks, believe it or not, which were enemies of Jesus. Check this out. The scribes and the Pharisees, the religious folks of that time, he says, sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to, observe. In other words, you know, we got to do what they're saying because they're in Moses' seat. That observe and do. But look, but do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do. For they bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do to be seen by men. They make their phylacteries broad and enlarge the borders of their garments. You know, they wear these religious-type garments. They love the best places at feast, the best seats in the synagogues, greetings in the marketplaces. Notice they're really puffing themselves up. And to be called by men, Rabbi, Rabbi. Notice they're more interested in men liking them than the approval of God. But you do not be called Rabbi, for one is your teacher, the Christ. And you are all brethren. In other words, no one's over you. We're all brothers. He says, do not call anyone on earth your father, for one is your father, he who is in heaven. And do not be called teachers, for one is your teacher, the Christ. But he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. So he's saying, look, you want to be something, then you need to be a servant. And he says, and whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now he goes through this, look at, let me highlight it, this woe to you thing. Like, in other words, he's saying, hey, look, the pain is a coming. You guys are in for a a heck of a lot of hurt. Look at, woe to you, all this. Let's go through it. He says, but woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Guys, this is sweet, gentle, meek Jesus saying this. He says, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. He's saying basically, look, you're not going to go to heaven and you're causing other people not to go in, they're stopping them from going in. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. He says it again. For you devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. Notice what he's saying here. You know how people say, oh, Jesus doesn't judge. Well, look what it says. He says, therefore you will receive greater condemnation. This is the real Jesus, guys. This isn't the phony Jesus the world teaches you about. Get into the Word. Look what the real Jesus said. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. Again, hypocrites. For you travel land and sea to win one proselyte. And when he is won, look what sweet, gentle, meek Jesus says, which is why I love him so. He is not politically correct. He says, and when you won this proselyte, in other words, now he's going to think like you, he goes, you make him twice as much as the son of hell as yourselves. Whoa, this is pretty heavy. Again, he says, woe to you blind guides. This phrase, blind guides, it's like they're trying to guide someone somewhere, and the person trying to guide them is blind. He's calling them blind guides, which is like a double put down here. He says, you say, whoever swears by the temple, it is nothing, but whoever swears by the gold of the temple, he is obliged to perform it. He's calling them fools. He goes, fools and blind, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whoever swears by the altar, it is nothing, but whoever swears by the gift that is on it, he is obliged to perform it. Fools and blind. For which is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? Therefore, he who swears by the altar swears by it and by all things on it. He who swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And he who swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits on it. Again, he's not done. Jesus is laying down this righteous anger here, where he's showing them that they're doing the wrong thing. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law. And look how awesome the heart of Jesus is. He says, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. And then Jesus really knows how to speak awesome. I mean, no one spoke better than him. Look what he says. He goes, blind guides who strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Basically, they're straining this little tiny gnat, but they're swallowing a camel. In other words, they're just idiots. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. He's not done, guys. He says, hypocrites. For you cleanse the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of extortion and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first cleanse the inside of the cup and dish, that the outside of them may be clean also. Now, this is epic what Jesus says here. I mean, it's so poetic and it's so powerful. You ever go to like a cemetery and you see like the headstones and stuff? Well, he's kind of referring to these tombs here. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. And then he compares them to this. He goes, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly. And this is epic. He goes, but inside are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. I mean, this is putting them down. He's really just telling them, you know, that they're full of just dead men's bones and uncleanness. They're full of it. Watch. He goes, even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. Guys, this is sweet, gentle, meek Jesus. This is God. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. You're just getting started, hypocrites. because you build the tombs of the prophets and adorn the monuments of the righteous and say, if we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would have not been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. Therefore you are witnesses against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of your father's guilt. Then he calls them serpents, a brood of vipers. And look what he says, guys. How can you escape the condemnation of hell? He says, therefore indeed I send you prophets. Wait a minute. Notice he's speaking, Jesus is speaking, very authoritative. He's saying he's God sending prophets, wise men, and scribes. And he says, some of them you will kill and crucify, and some of them you will scourge in your synagogues and persecute from city to city, that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. I mean, this is extremely authoritative. He says, assuredly, I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. Then he says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. And now he starts speaking of Jerusalem, how much, you know, he's longing for Jerusalem to turn back to him. He says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. And then here you see Jesus' heart again. He goes, how often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but look, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. All right, let's move on. Man, that was intense. He's telling them off. Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. Now, as he sat at the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, tell us, when will these things be? And look at, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Now watch this. This is interesting. He's talking about Jesus' return. So if you want to know what the signs will be, here we go. He's going to talk about it. And it's interesting that immediately he warns us not to be tricked. That's like he starts off with that. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. So that's just, you know, it's getting ready to get started there. Then he says, for nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And notice, and there will be famines, pestilences. And it's interesting, looks like the earth's going to have some massive earthquakes in various places. All these are, notice, the beginning of sorrows. So that's the beginning of it, right here. Now, Jesus doesn't mince words. He says what's in store for, well, let me just let the passage read itself. He says, then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. So it looks like the world starts getting very hateful and arrogant, and the love of many grows cold here, he says. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because, notice, lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Do you know in the Great Depression, crime was pretty low? And what a lot of people in law enforcement are scared of, they're saying if something ever happens with our economy like that, the Great Depression, it's not going to be like back in those days where we were a more moral, loving nation. They said it's going to be like anarchy. So it's going to be different if you know, as the economy gets worse and worse. It's not going to be like where people stick together like back in the Great Depression times. But then he says, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. And then notice it says, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is in the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days, and pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath. For then, now notice, it gets so bad that if God didn't step in, everyone would die, it seems like. Look, I'll let the passage read for itself. It says, for then there will be great tribulation. Notice, not just tribulation, which is bad enough, great tribulation, such has not been since the beginning of the world. In other words, the worst has ever been until this time, no, nor ever shall be. It's going to be worse than what Hitler did. It's going to be worse than all the wars combined. Notice, and so bad that Jesus says, and unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone says to you, notice he keeps saying this, he keeps saying there's a whole, you get this essence from reading this that people are going to be trying to trick you. Because he's saying that people are going to be saying they're the Christ, and he keeps saying, notice, and will deceive many. And remember how he says, let's see, take heed that no one deceives you. Notice the whole thing here that Jesus is saying is all about people trying to deceive you and I. So, again, he says it. Therefore, if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, or there, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. In other words, remember I told you this part, because there's going to be people saying, you know, this person's the Christ, you know. Now, it's interesting. There's this phrase here. He says, therefore, if they say to you, look, he is in the desert, he says, do not go out. Or look, he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For as the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For wherever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together. Now it looks like some pretty terrifying times. I'm just saying it the way it is, guys. I mean, when you read this, no one would disagree that this is pretty scary stuff. He says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And this part, though, is awesome. Imagine this. He says, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Now learn this parable from the fig tree. When its branch has already become tender and puts forth leaves, you know that summer is near. And this is why we do these Bible studies, guys. We want to be prepared. So he says, so you also, when you see all these things, know that it is near at the doors. Like, it's almost time. Assuredly, I say to you, this generation, which generation? The one that witnesses all these things, will by no means pass away till all these things take place. So it's going to happen rapidly. When it hits, it's going to happen rapidly, one after another. He's saying that generation's not going to pass away till all these things take place. He says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. Because remember, we're going to have a new heaven and a new earth. Remember what we talked to you about Abraham and Isaac and the promise that God gave them? Look, he's saying it again, my words will by no means pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, remember in the days of Noah before the flood, people were just going on daily with their daily routine. It was like right up to the day, people were just going on like oblivious to it all. He says, just like the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. So it could be like, let's say you woke up tomorrow and it happened. It's not going to be like some change where people are stopping living their lives even through all this. Look, he says, for as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until that day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken, the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, and then he's basically in this phrase here, it's like he's saying, look, here's what you should do if you're intelligent, if you're wise, this is a smart thing to do. That's why he says, but know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. In other words, if someone said someone's going to break in your house between the hour of 7 o'clock and 8 o'clock, you're going to make sure you're there 7 o'clock and 8 o'clock, you know, to secure your house. He says, therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. And let's end it with this. The faithful servant and the evil servant. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his master made ruler over his household to give them food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he comes, will find so doing. Assuredly, I say to you that he will make him ruler over all his goods. But if that evil servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunkards, the master of that servant will come on a day when he is not looking for him, and at an hour that he is not aware of, and will cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So let's see, we're going to see, we might do one more page here. Let's see. Okay, we'll do one more page because this is important. When you read scripture and they talk about oil right here in Matthew 25:3. Oil is like a type of the Holy Spirit. Okay. He says, then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. And when they say virgins, it's like bridesmaids, you know, like in today we call them bridesmaids. So you have these 10 bridesmaids, okay, 10 virgins. So now 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. So let's look why some were wise and why the other were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps, but while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard. And by the way, you're not going to understand this. Like, you know, today when people get married, especially in Western culture, you just schedule the wedding, you know, you go get married, right? But that's not how it was back then. What would happen is you wouldn't really know when the bridegroom is coming, and it might be a day, 2 days, 3 days, and then it was this very beautiful procession where they would see him coming across the valley with all his family and his loved ones and stuff, and they would say, the bridegroom is coming, and we would go out, you would go out to meet him and stuff, and that's how they would do it back then when you're going to get married. That's why he's saying, and at midnight a cry was heard. Notice you could even show up at midnight. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And matter of fact, Johnny Cash, you should look for a video on YouTube when the man comes around. look for that. That was one of Johnny Cash's latest songs he wrote. And he refers to this phrase in that song. He says the virgins are all trimming their lamps, their wicks. And he says, then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, you know, they're like, quick, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for us and you. But go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. So this is a type of, notice, the wedding is, you're going to heaven, you're going to be celebrating and honoring God, and you're going to this feast. And notice the people that were not saved, they were not full of the Holy Spirit. The oil represents Holy Spirit. Notice they're not able to attend. So notice afterward the other virgins came, the ones that weren't really, didn't have enough oil, right? And oil is a type of Holy Spirit. They come back and they're like, Lord, Lord, open to us. You know, the door's closed. But notice he answered and said, assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. So God bless you guys. Thanks for listening. And I guess this is the last paragraph right here, so we'll end off here. I want to jump to the Son of Man will judge the nations. So this is what Jesus says. He says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him. And look what he does. He will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. So the people that bash Jesus, the people that mock Jesus and stuff, he's going to separate them. And then the people like you, the people like me that were not ashamed of Jesus Christ, he's going to separate us in a different area. And notice he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you in the foundation of this world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, well, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, notice, my brethren, you did it to me. But what about the ones that were anti-Jesus? Let's look what sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus says to the Jesus Christ bashers, the people that want to turn people away from Jesus Christ. And it's not good news. Then he will also say to those on the left hand, now guys, this is sweet, gentle, meek Jesus saying this, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not take me in. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me. Then they will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick in prison and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. God bless you guys. Don't forget to go to shotgunhell.net and get your free audio Bible. You can click right below this video and you can go there or manually type it in. And then also you can watch the entire movie Passion of the Christ. I love you guys. Thanks for watching again. Have a great week.